Ew. Gotta get rid of this old Backstreet Boys t-shirt.
Tell me why.
Because it stinks, boys.
Tell me why.
I've washed it so many times, but the odor won't come out.
Tell me why.
No, you tell me why I can't get rid of this odor.
Have you tried Downy Rinse and Refresh? It doesn't just cover up odors. It helps remove them.
Wow, it worked, guys.
Yeah.
Downy Rinse and Refresh removes more odor in one wash than the leading value detergent in three washes. Find it wherever you buy laundry products.
You're listening to a Weeby Geeks Network podcast.
Merry Christmas!
What is this?
Up to Neverland!
Ho, 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 ho! Come in and know me better, man! Ho, ho!
Merry, Merry Christmas! Merry, Merry Christmas! Merry, Merry Christmas!
Take your pixies out of your pockets, because it's Christmas time. That's a good reason, right?
Yep.
Well, also, it's because I'm here. It's your spider pan, Jeremy, and I'm here to lead you on to Neverland. So take that pixie out of your pocket, sprinkle some of that pixie dust. Heck, do you have a little bit of that, you know, that sprinkly kind of tinsel kind of stuff you put on your tree?
Glitter?
Well, no, but yeah, it's glittery, but it's tinsel-y, and you can just sprinkle it on your tree. Have you never used tinsel like that on
your
tree?
Is this a stringy tinsel?
Well, yeah, it's like a stringy, and it looks like icicles on your Christmas tree when you put it. You ever use that?
Yes.
Okay, makes a real mess. That's a real pain to clean up later.
I was just thinking.
But yeah, sprinkle some of that because it's Christmas time. Yay! So we get to have some holiday fun. We're not going to talk a whole lot because I have a very long event that I was able to go to with Grant Curtis, producer of several films, which I will talk about here in a little bit. So we're just going to dive right into, we have a little bit of news, and we also have a really cool trailer that we're going to talk about. So let's just dive straight into some news.
Spanning the Disney and geek universe to bring you the best in comics, toys, movies, and entertainment. This is news from around Neverland.
On December 5th, there's something neat that's happening at the park.
Epcot, to be specific.
Epcot specifically, yep.
Yes.
They are going to transform Epcot into the Death Star.
Specifically, Spaceship Earth.
Okay, sorry, Spaceship Earth.
Spaceship Earth. For those who don't know, that is the large golf ball kind of looking globe that is kind of the symbol for Epcot. And with some projection technology, it's going to look like a Death Star. Now, who didn't see something like this coming with Star Wars when Disney bought Star Wars? Wouldn't you have expected they would try to do something like this at some point?
Well, I personally didn't see it, but it does make sense.
Yes, I knew at some point, I think a lot of us knew at some point they were going to do this.
So this is going to, the event will begin to stream, so you can watch it on your computer.
Yeah, because this is an after-hours event, but it's all RSVP'd up, so you can't get there if you don't already have tickets.
Yeah, but you can see it. It's 10:25 p.m.
Eastern time.
Eastern time. Yes, that's important to note.
Mm-hmm.
It'll
be on the Disney Parks blog. Very important. They're going to put a specific post up. Very specific post. So keep your eye on Disney Parks blog at about... Well, for us in Central Time, it's going to be about 9:25. They will put it up there, and you'll be able to look at it changing into the Death Star. I'm sure they might have some fun animations, because with, I guess it was around the time for Monsters University, they did turn it into Mike Wazowski.
That's fun.
Did some fun animation, yeah. Which they only did it once. I guess that's what this is. This is for Rogue One, a little bit of celebration. So maybe the Death Star will do something. Maybe it'll fire on the audience with some neat little laser show. Who knows? But there's some sort of big event. But Disney Parks blog. It's, of course, disneyparks.disney.go.com/blog/2016. That type of thing. They will be putting something up. Google search it. They'll put up a fresh new post by that time so you can watch it streaming live. It may be the only chance you're going to get to see it. This is weird news. Okay. Now, despite where you're thinking for the past election, this was, I thought, just interesting. So, Donald Trump... he's been putting together his cabinet and everything, getting ready to take on the role of president. But he put together a group of advisors that are all CEOs. And one of them includes Bob Iger, the CEO, or chief executive officer, of the Walt Disney Company.
Which is interesting. Yeah.
Very interesting. Especially considering Bob Iger donated money to Hillary Clinton's campaign and voted for her and has been a big supporter. But he had some nice things to say when Trump won. I've seen some footage, I believe it was on CNBC. But he basically was saying that he's being very hopeful about how things are going to go, and he said it looks like the transition is going good. But he said he would like to see the corporate tax rate lowered and some loopholes closed. And they have a quote from him here: "It's possible that given what's gone on this week, that's likely to be addressed sooner than later." And that's obviously a good thing. So he had some things he was looking for with some corporate code and some tax code. And so it's him and some people from, I believe, where was it? J.P. Morgan, General Motors, and Walmart. Some of all their CEOs are all on this advisory panel to kind of take a look at corporate tax code and see if there's some things that can help stimulate the economy a little bit better. And Bob Iger has really stimulated Disney's economy, as we can say. Mm-hmm. Granted, there was a big money loss with Shanghai, but everything else has really been a lot of good ideas, and so I think he'll be helpful, and it's nice to have somebody, I guess, that thinks a little differently from Trump to get in there and, balance the equation, So, I've already seen some people who are like, oh, no, because it's connected with Trump, they already want to be upset about it. I'm like, leave it be. This is actually kind of interesting that he chose somebody from Disney into the advisor thing, and so I find it to be kind of interesting, and I like to see what happens from that. Okay, we have a really cool teaser trailer to talk about.
All right, y'all. One more time. It don't matter what you look like. It don't nobody gonna sing with me. Okay.
The Neverland Trailer Park.
The fate of the universe lies on your shoulders. Now, whatever you do, don't push this button, because that will set off the bomb immediately and we'll all be dead. Now repeat back what I just said.
I am Groot.
No! No, that's the button that will kill everyone. Try again.
I am Groot.
Mm-hmm.
I am Groot.
Uh-huh.
I am Groot.
No!
Showtime, a-holes. Ah! Over the death button.
Nobody has any tape.
Not a single person has tape.
You have an atomic bomb in your bag. If anybody's gonna have tape, it's you.
I have to do everything.
You are wasting a lot of time.
That's a really bad sign.
If I touch someone, I can feel their feelings.
You feel love.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, I feel a general unselfish love for just about everybody.
No, sexual love.
No, I don't.
For her.
No.
She just told everyone your deepest, darkest secret.
Dude, come on. I think you're overreacting a little bit.
You must be so embarrassed. Do me.
Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Now, previously, we did get to see a little bit, but that was almost like a teaser for a teaser.
Yeah.
He was just wanting to share a little something and didn't really get a chance to pick any different music for it. We still had Hooked on a Feeling being played with it, but this...
Which is fine, because it's a good song.
Yeah. So, we got to take a little bit of a peek at some things already, but this is an official teaser, and it's funny as heck.
Yeah, they're going to keep the fun-loving, kind of rascally nature of this group and of the first, feel of the first movie. Mm-hmm. They're in way over their heads, and they're trying to figure it out. And it's like kind of at the end, I wondered if that was a therapist or something like that. If they sat down and were trying to work out their interpersonal, issues or something.
I don't know.
Because I just wondered, just the way, she was like, oh, I can feel people's feelings and emotions and stuff. And we know there's some tension within the group of, odd personalities trying to get along.
Conflicting personalities, despite mm-hmm. the... the sort of family-oriented sort of thing that they've gotten together, that Groot has brought them together, that we are Groot. So, you know, they're a tight-knit group in their own ways. But, yeah, there's always going to be some little bit of a bump in the road and everything. Well,
families even, you know,
yeah,
fuss amongst themselves. So, you know, it would make sense that they kind of got to work out some things.
Yeah. And I did find it interesting, though, that we have a baby Groot.
Mm-hmm. Because Baby Groot is going to be very interesting.
Well, I think Groot showed a lot of ability to grow when he needed something, grow some parts and stuff. Mm-hmm. I thought he would be able to grow himself up, but you know, just for the fun of it, keep him as a baby Groot for a little while, because we can have some fun with that idea.
Well, maybe the difference is like you have the core of like almost like his body, like what Groot, you know, was. You know, and the trauma from the first movie, like at the end, you know, was so bad that part's going to grow back very slowly, but his branches, his appendages, if you will, that's more regenerative, like faster.
Yeah, because he was able to grow back his arms in the first one fairly quickly.
And he still kicks butt. Yeah. He's still a baby Groot. He kicks butt.
We do get to see a point where he vines out and snags a guy.
Yes!
So he can still do that. So he can still rapidly grow parts of his body, but his overall core self doesn't seem to be growing. But another interesting question that I think is brought up is, okay, so Rocket's got this device here, and one button will detonate something and kill us all, and the other one, I guess, won't. Why would he even put that button there?
Why would you build that?
But that's just something Rocket would do. It makes sense. He was like, yes, of course there's an instant death button, because Rocket would do that.
It's Rocket made like that.
Yes. So, it just makes sense. But this, of course, did a really good job, this teaser, to generate more excitement, because as if there wasn't already some excitement for a second go around. You know, there's definitely some excitement in there. It's right now currently the number one trending thing on YouTube. Shocker. And having just debuted actually on Saturday night. So, yeah, definitely looking forward to this one. Looking forward to some new trailers. And even I have been seeing a lot of information from like a convention in Brazil. That they showed just a little bit of a tease for Spider-Man Homecoming. And I've seen some video that actually the Sony Pictures Brazil branch showed a reaction, and everybody's just cheering and going crazy. Of course, it's a convention. We get excited anyway. So I don't necessarily hold that fully as what you should expect. However, that is encouraging still. I mean...
I'll have to wait and see.
They didn't boo at it. But so this is just some teaser, but the only thing we know is we see Peter Parker talking to Happy Hogan. Although I guess you don't really get such a good look at Happy Hogan.
Who's
necessarily.
Happy Hogan,
that was Jon Favreau, the director of the first two Iron Man films. He was in all three. He's kind of the right-hand man for Tony. You know, he's the driver. He was working security at Iron Man 3. You know, he was in the building.
Oh, okay. Yes, I gotcha.
Played
I'm
by
sorry.
Jon Favreau.
Yeah.
But so we see him, and then Tony Stark bringing a briefcase to Peter. And from what we've heard about, what people saw in this new suit is the old classic web wings.
Okay, I know.
You know what I'm talking
seen
about.
Pictures of web wings.
Yeah, so he's going to have the webbing there in the arms. And apparently some sort of a new suit even coming along. So we are expecting to be able to have a teaser or a trailer or something very soon online. I'm expecting we'll get to see it in front of Rogue One. Probably we'll get to see this Guardians trailer in front of Rogue One
as
well. So definitely, in case you didn't have enough reason to go see Rogue One, now you have even more reasons to go see Rogue One. Okay, so speaking of Spider-Man, all right, I at the UCM, University of Central Missouri, where both of us are actually going to school, you're getting your master's, and did we never even introduce, did anybody not remember who she is? Say hello.
Hello.
And tell them who you are.
This is Heather, bio nerd.
Yes.
Yeah, Wendy nerd, excuse me.
Yeah, the
Wendy nerd, excuse me.
The Wendy nerd, yes. So
I'm letting out my secret identity here.
Yeah. But yeah, we didn't tell him, just in case people forget. You haven't been on the show in a while.
No, I've been busy.
Yeah. But so have I over at UCM. But Wednesday night, I got in for free because I'm a student there. I didn't get to do the backstage event. But we had Hollywood producer Grant Curtis there. Now, he graduated. He grew up in Warrensburg, graduated from MU, and then got his master's. He actually graduated with a marketing degree. But then got his master's over at University of Central Missouri, which would have been Central Missouri State University at the time. Mm-hmm. Now, if the name isn't ringing a bell, let me read for you what we actually had in the program. It says, producer Grant Curtis has been making motion pictures for over 20 years. Most recently, he served as an executive producer on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Out of the Shadows for Paramount Pictures, which arrived in theaters June 3rd, 2016. Additionally, Delaney, a film he directed, wrote and produced for ESPN Films 30 for 30 Shorts, documentary series premiered on August 19th, 2015. There's one Disney connection. He currently has film and television projects in development with Lionsgate, Gold Circle Films, and Linmar Entertainment, among others. From the mystical drama The Gift, starring Kate Blanchett, Hilary Swank, Keanu Reeves, Greg Kinnear, Katie Holmes, and Giovanni Ribisi, the eye-popping Oz the Great and Powerful, starring James Franco, Mila Kunis, Rachel Weisz, Michelle Williams, and Zach Braff. There's another Disney connection for you. Curtis has been instrumental in bringing some of celebrated director Sam Raimi's most creative and vibrant projects to the screen. Curtis has devoted much of his tenure as a producer to supporting Raimi's vision of the wildly acclaimed Spider-Man franchise. We're talking, of course, the Tobey Maguire trilogy. This extraordinary trilogy starring Tobey Maguire, didn't I just say that?
Yeah.
Kirsten Dunst and James Franco received multiple Academy Award nominations, broke new ground in visual effects, and garnered the approval and admiration of comic book purists. All three films broke box office records during their respective 2002, 2004, and 2007 openings. In 2009, Curtis entered the world of Supernatural, partnering with Raimi on the horror hit Drag Me to Hell. The Universal Pictures release starring Alison Lohman and Justin Long garnered critical acclaim as one of the most fun and terrifying horror movies in years. For the small screen, Curtis has produced the pilot, fourth episode of Rake, starring Greg Kinnear for the 20th Century Fox Television and Sony Pictures Television. Never heard of that one. In addition to producing, Curtis has the distinction of being a published author, penning the behind-the-scenes books, The Spider-Man Chronicles, The Art and Making of Spider-Man 3, and The Art of Oz the Great and Powerful. A graduate of the University of Missouri with a bachelor's degree in marketing, Curtis went on to receive a master's degree in mass communications from the University of Central Missouri. Curtis was a recipient of the UCM Alumni Association Outstanding Recent Alumnus Award in 2002. And he was in town. They're raising money to actually renovate one of the theaters on campus, the Hendrix Theater. And so they were selling these tickets for $50 a shot. A lot of the people in the audience were actually people that went to high school with him or knew him because he grew up in Warrensburg. So yet another famous Missourian. How cool is that? Now, when I play this audio, this is a long audio. It's going to be an hour and 10 minutes. But when I first play this, you're going to hear actually a little bit from The Gift, from some of the trailers for Spider-Man. You're going to hear a little bit from Drag Me to Hell. You'll just have to recognize it by sound if you're familiar with these movies, because there's, you know, text on the screen that it was showing each one. And there is some various different places where they did show some video, and had some videos that were sent in from various actual UCM students that he has worked with as associate producers. So there will be some video in here. Really great, fun, a lot of good information, especially if you are in any fashion interested and perhaps working in this industry, or if you're not interested in working in the industry, but you are interested in the industry itself. Great conversation. But enough of me babbling on. I think I should just get straight to it, shouldn't I?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, well, here we go with Grant Curtis.
To Disney and beyond. Oh!
Please welcome Grant. And,
what does this mean?
I see things.
Yeah.
Sense. Things that, well, they hadn't happened yet, or they were happening someplace else. My granny told me that I had a gift that runs in my family, and she told me that I shouldn't be afraid of it. I should just always use my instinct, and I'd be all right.
Not everyone is meant to make a difference, but for me, the choice to live an ordinary life is no longer an option.
Something.
Just one kiss.
I beg for anything but love. I love it. I beg for you. I beg you.
Please look at me.
Leave me alone. Forget it.
Begging to me.
I am not sitting. You are here at last, and the prophecy shall be fulfilled. This is my sister, Evanora. I'm here to serve you. The royal treasure of Oz. It belongs to you, but only after you defeat the wicked witch.
Just how wicked is she?
Towns were destroyed. Children were orphaned. A great wizard from Kansas. I've waited for you to come.
This is my recital.
Bogey's on the bus.
I think it's very vital.
Hit the button.
What button? There are a million buttons.
Brothers who hate bullies and love this city.
I'm sorry, I haven't seen some of those pictures in a long time. Oh my goodness. Much thinner man back then.
I think every family has the church yearbook photo. That was my favorite.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of the batch there. So, well, as I said, every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And, I think we can only imagine how phenomenal the end is going to be with this kind of beginning. I think it makes sense. And this is. It's sort of tough to. In fact, let me put my timer on so I stay. With great power comes great responsibility. Peter Parker's uncle impressed that upon me. So I'll try to keep us so we have time for an audience Q&A.
By the way, kudos to the editor of those clips, because I'm sure my mom tried to squash the Drag Me to Hell clips. So thank you for who's ever gutsy enough to go against her wishes and include that movie that the poster to this day does not hang in our house. I can't figure out why, but so that was good to see.
Was it modeled after anyone that you?
Not at all.
Well, let's start at the beginning. I mean, you're not only an alum of University of Central Missouri, but you grew up in Lawrenceburg.
True.
So, what was growing up in Lawrenceburg like in terms of the impact on what you're doing now and how you got where you are?
When we were growing up, I don't know if there's a heck of a lot of familiar faces in the audience. So I think a lot of you know where I grew up, on 100, 200 acres between here and Nomnoster. And my childhood was spent largely going out and entertaining myself and my cousins and friends with, forts and making up stories and making up wars and fights and battles. And I have a few scars to prove those battles. But that was my childhood, is going out and trying to think up stories and ways to not get too many noogies and try to survive the day. But I miss it to this day. I think we talked earlier. I think I had the honor of being on the air with Woody this morning, and it's a big difference growing up on 200 acres to Los Angeles, where I could reach out and almost touch all my neighbors. But that was my childhood. I think I was born. Well, I know I was born in Columbia, Missouri, and then probably. Two or three, maybe, we moved here, and I'm a proud alum of the Lawrenceburg Tiger school system.
Yeah.
And former star of middle school plays, is that right?
There's a few. Back, interestingly, as we also discussed today, I'm in the Screen Actors Guild, as odd as that sounds, because I cannot act to save my life. But I've been in 3 movies, and so I have my SAG card. But I also, in middle school, thought I could act, and so I gave it a try and quickly realized that I was not the man to be in front of the camera. But I did do some school plays back in the day.
So what did you want to be when you were living in Warrensburg, and you thought, okay, when I grow up, I want to be...
I wanted to make movies. I didn't, you know, it was hard to see that as a possibility or as an opportunity, because I don't think anybody in Warrensburg had really gone that path before in Los Angeles. But I always wanted to figure out how to tell stories and entertain people.
So you don't run into a lot of your neighbors on Sunset Boulevard?
Not on sets, no.
Yeah, but, interesting. So when you were growing up, tell me about your influences here. Favorite activities, church memories, you know, what are those influences that you're bringing now to the art of producing movies?
My big influencers were my parents. To this day, they still are. Those were the number one and two. Big influences, my brother and my cousins, and also, you know, I had great teachers. Mr. John Willard was my art teacher in high school, and even though I could not draw, he encouraged me every day to continue to try to create something. And even though it was probably extremely painful for him to grade some of my drawings and paintings, he did it with a smile on his face and always tried to turn every failure that I would produce into an opportunity to teach about art and creativity and trying to better yourself. Miss Lawton, who I know her name is no longer Miss Lawton, but I think it's Miss Hasler, maybe. Probably just butchered that, but she was also my journalism teacher and always encouraged me to write and to tell stories, and that was great. I had a lot of great teachers. I mean, as I know it is now, the Warrensburg school system was filled with people who were extremely encouraging and tried to light fires, and it was a great upbringing.
So do you have favorite movies from your youth that stand out?
Absolutely. It would have to be probably what we all share, a lot of Star Wars, E.T., Extraterrestrial. The Indiana Jones films were huge. And one of the things I think we're going to talk about tonight, so I don't want to steal any of your thunder, but I taught History of American Film this semester in the communications department. And one of the things that was fun for me to be able to do was give a little bit of my movie-going history to my students as it would be applicable in the class, because as you guys probably remember a lot, the campus twin, and that's where I grew up going to movies down over across from Dairy Queen and Quick Trip, and so I was able to infuse a little bit of old Warrensburg geography and movie-going into the class, but it was those classics.
And any books that you were really...
Big fan of C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters and Tolkien, those guys.
Yeah, classic stuff.
Good ones.
Yeah. So you left Warrensburg High and you came for a year to Central Missouri.
Yes.
And then got lured somehow slightly to the east.
Slightly. I graduated from Mizzou, I believe in 94, and the only reason I say believe, it did take me a little longer than a traditional student to graduate. 94 with a bachelor's in marketing.
And what brought you, what was the impetus other than home-cooked meals for coming back to Central Missouri to get your master's degree?
My first job in the quote-unquote real world was I worked for the Kansas City Blades Hockey Club back when you guys probably remember they were members of the International Hockey League, and I was in their sales department. And I enjoyed it, but I was missing the opportunity, I thought, to tell stories and to do what I really wanted to do. So I also took the opportunity to come back here and get a master's degree, which allowed me to focus. Like, my master's was in mass communication with an emphasis in screenwriting. And that was why I came back here, and it was one of the better decisions of my life.
And were you doing projects and films during that time?
My cousins and I, we would always grab my Uncle Gary and Janice's camera and go out and shoot very embarrassing videos that I hope are in some vault or destroyed now. And I remember shooting, there's a lot of good blackmail material out there, I know.
Also, those can be duped as fundraising. Yeah,
they spread very quickly, like the plague. But also shot a short film. The Scullies were kind enough, I don't even know if they remember, but we shot a short film at Heroes one weekend. So I would grab any camera when I could. It was different back then, as you know. It was film, and it wasn't... Yeah. You weren't able to do what you are now on a phone and on cameras, but it was a great time to tell stories without the pressure and the pitfalls and the opportunities.
So initially, you'd worked for the Blades, and I think you wanted to go into sports marketing, and True. You did that for a while, right?
Absolutely.
What was that?
It was a blast. I worked with Mitch Wheeler, who's an alumni. I worked at Marketing Associates International in Overland Park on State Line Road. And I believe we worked on, was it the 94 Olympics? 94, yes. And that was when the Olympics were here in the United States and soccer was growing, and also did some work with, I remember, a triathlete. And it was a good time to, because to this day, I mean, my true love is sports. Because I think, you know, a lot of what we do is make-believe, and it's a very impactful medium, and it's a medium that entertains and excites and scares and makes people laugh. But I've always been drawn to sports as well, because those are real stories that you're watching play out real time.
Excites, entertains, makes you laugh. You weren't interested in politics at any point?
No, not politics.
Okay. You just described... never mind. No, we won't go there.
I should be interviewing you, by the way.
Yes, right.
Yes, absolutely.
So... You know, something stimulated this decision that you weren't going to do sports marketing. You were going to go to Hollywood. What triggered that?
I think I realized that that was my opportunity. You know, I was not married. I was not encumbered, and it was easy to pivot. And I thought, might as well try and probably fail at 21, because there's a soft landing at 21. So I did it.
Is this the classic, load up the car, you know?
Drive across I-70 with a bag phone. But I also, you know, my dad was the head of the Department of Communications for, I think, 25 years, Dad, maybe 20. I'm giving you an extra 5 years. You should take it, man. But he, two of his faculty members, among a lot of great faculty members, was a gentleman named Keith Mellinger, who got his MFA in screenwriting at UCLA, and he was a great mentor for me while I was here. And also Mr. John Graves, who was a Hollywood producer who worked on, I think he worked on the Incredible Hulk series and a lot of other TV shows, and he came here to teach, and he was a great mentor to me while I was here. And they were both extremely encouraging, realistic, but also wanted to push me out the door, and they helped me take the trip across I-70 and the black Honda Accord.
And you landed and immediately became a producer, I'm sure.
Or was not at all.
Or was there perhaps a random act of kindness somewhere in this story that...
There was a random act of paying my dues. I think that was what it was. One thing I had to do as I was finishing up my master's degree here was write a thesis, which my thesis was a screenplay. And I also had to do a internship, and I walked up to the communications job board, and there was a copy that said internships with the Late Late Show with Tom Snyder. And as we all know, Tom is no longer with us, but back then, after David Letterman, Tom Snyder would come on. And
great hair,
a great journalist, very smart, and what was absolutely phenomenal, if that's a word, it's not a word. But what was great is every night he was live to New York. And so I would work on stuff that morning or the previous week that I saw a quick turnaround. And we don't get that in movies very often. It took us 2.5 years to make Spider-Man 3. But that was it was my earliest job. And it really was neat to see a guy, a journalist at the top of his craft, going live every night, working without a net and that was my start at CBS.
Wow. Now, there was a random act of kindness involved, I think, carrying some groceries.
Well, maybe the random act of kindness. I became friends with the girl who was living in the apartment next to me as I was doing my internship. And she asked me, she said, I've got a friend who's a director. He's looking for an assistant. Do you want to interview for the job? And I said, yes. And that director was a gentleman named Sam Raimi, who I still work with to this day and still friends with. And I was very surprised I got the job and started working on the first film I did was a movie called A Simple Plan with Billy Bob Thornton and Bill Paxton and Bridget Fonda, 97, I think. I can't remember.
Well, we've got a clip from a friend of yours who has some memories and a question for you as well. So why don't we play that?
Hey everybody, I'm Jeremy Wheeler. I am a Mule, UCM Mule, and I'm also a writer and producer out here in LA. And I got my start as an intern and then as an assistant working for Grant. So even though I didn't get the chance to be there tonight, I wanted to take a moment and say hello to all of you and hey Granty. Just pass along a message for the evening and hopefully a little bit of insight about what it is like to work for Grant. One thing I will never forget, one of my first experiences working in this business was when I was an intern on Spider-Man 3, Topher Grace, who was the actor who played Venom on Spider-Man 3, pulled me aside on set one day and said, hey man, I just want you to know, you're working with Grant Curtis, who is my favorite producer that I've ever had the chance to work with in this business. You are never going to have a better gig than this working in Hollywood. He is absolutely the best guy you'll ever find in this town. And I will say that through my experience, that is absolutely true. And I've heard so many things like that about Grant. He's fine. The thing people don't know about Grant, and the thing I wanted to share, is that, for many of you, you probably know Dan and Linda Curtis. They are Warren's birth neighbors. And they're Grant's parents. And they are antique collectors. If you've ever been to their home is full of beautiful antiques that they have collected from around the world. Now, Grant also fancies himself an antique collector. The difference is that the things Grant considers antiques are more like railroad ties and rusted hunks of scrap metal that he has collected from warehouses and dungeons. And I don't know where he comes up with these things. But the problem is Jen will not let him bring them home for good reason. So they all end up in his office. And on productions, we move offices all the time, depending on what phase of production we're in. We're nomads. So we might have two or three different offices over the course of a year. Now, Grant, for all of his aw shucks Missouri charm, does not move his own office. That responsibility would always fall to me. So I would find myself not only lugging all of his 10-ton pieces of scrap metal around, his antiques, excuse me, but he also seemingly has every paperclip and post-it note that he's ever had from every movie he's ever worked on, and it's all a traveling circus that I end up with. That is the glamorous, true story of working with Grant. But I think, the thing I've come to realize, is I think that maybe the lesson he was trying to teach me, the moral of that, was that there is no task too small and there is no piece of scrap too large to need the service of. And that is definitely one thing that's true about Grant, is that he will do absolutely anything for the movie. And I think that is one of the reasons that people love him and respect him so much and will do anything to work with him, is that they know they're, despite the fact that it's Hollywood, a town that may surprise you, is full of egos and agendas. He has no agenda other than making the movie the absolute best that it can be. And that is an incredibly refreshing and unique thing in this business. And that is definitely the biggest takeaway that I have from working with him. And the way he goes about it, the way he treats people, is with the utmost integrity. And that is something that is rare in any business, but certainly rare in this business. And that is the biggest thing that I've had the opportunity to learn from Grant. One question that I wanted to give him the opportunity to answer tonight was that since I got my start as an intern and then as an assistant, Grant got into the business himself as an assistant, and I believe it was actually a PA, production assistant, before that. How has that path changed, and what would be the best path for someone who wants to break into business now as a producer? So, Grant, I will give you the floor, and everyone, I promise you that his answer to this will be the most wise, mind-blowing, insightful response that you will ever hear to anything. Granted, you have the floor. Good night, everybody.
He was kind to me. He knows where all the bodies are buried. So that was actually very, very judicious on his part to not go too deep.
Well, you've been set up nicely here for absolutely a mind-blowing response to his question.
Yeah, no pressure there. To anybody who is wanting to jump into this business, or I would actually say that this is true for most businesses and most people looking to break in whatever field they want to do, is what I did is I tried to find people who did what I wanted to do, and then I would go and assist them. And it's a lot of menial chores and a lot of breaking into the business. But that's the best piece of advice I could give: is go find somebody who does what you want to do and do everything you can to learn from them. But also, if you want to be a filmmaker and if you want to try to make movies, you know what I always tell my students and what I tell kids that I talk to in Los Angeles is, go make movies on the weekends with your friends and your fellow students, and go learn the art and the craft of storytelling, because especially now with digital cameras and editing suites on your computers, and you can go make a movie, although it doesn't look like Oz the Great and Powerful or something like that, you can still go, I've got a fly buzzing me somewhere, but you can still go use all the editing techniques and the storytelling techniques and how to get performances out of actors and, you know, what laughs work and tension and all that. You can still learn that craft with your buddies and your pals on the weekends. So go do it.
And then to get paid, you start doing unglamorous tasks.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's, you know, like any business, like any profession or craft, you start at the bottom and you work hard and hopefully it pays off.
So I'm intrigued every time I hang around a movie after it ends and watch the credits roll at all of the different titles and all the different roles there seem to be. So help us understand, you know, I think we now understand from Jeremy, and thank Jeremy for his mention, what a production assistant does. I'm assuming he does things when he's not moving scrap iron.
Yeah, he broke it over digital age because I think he got tired of carrying the boxes around.
Yeah. Yes. But you know, sort of. So, what does a producer do? Because you know, we've all seen movies that have 8 or 10 people listed as producer, and probably 2 or 3 people listed as executive producer. So, you know, help us understand those titles and what they mean, and you know, kind of how you fit into those kinds of roles.
It varies from film to film or television show to television show. You know, a lot of times some executive producers help find the financing or bring the financing to the picture. The movies I've done in the past have all been studio movies, so I've worked with the studios, business affairs and accounting departments. I would say the best way that I think I usually answer that question is producing is the one job on a movie where you don't have the luxury of saying that's not my problem. Because you can never pass, there's no one else to pass the problem on to or to take care of the problem.
You do have a fly.
I do have a fly. It's a very aggressive one. But I think in a nutshell, as weird as that sounds, that is producing. It's trying to take care of problems, anticipate problems, and at the same time working with the director and the writer and trying to get his or her vision to the screen and working with the studio who's writing the checks and making sure that it's also a fiscally responsible production that hopefully makes money for them at the end of the day, because at the end of the day, it is a business. And one of our first jobs is entertain, and one of our second jobs, maybe it's the first job, is to make it financially responsible, and so we can keep taking more swings at the bat.
Yeah, we could probably do an entire separate evening on the financial aspects of movie making. We're not going to go there.
Please don't.
Net gross, the whole thing. You know, I think it boggles people's minds. So, you know, after the producers and the executive producers role, you see some very strange titles pop up. What's a grip?
A grip is very similar to these cameras that have tripods and the lights. A grip is a guy or gal who works with, you guys probably have seen them in pictures and stuff, they're called C-stands. And anything that really takes almost a little bit of a technical engineering skill to put together and to cobble together, whether it's lights, whether it's the cameras, whether it's the dolly, the grips are the guys and gals who are making those gadgets work and creating things on the set and on the fly to make a camera fly across New York and across Madison Square Garden.
What's a gaffer?
A gaffer is more of an electrician. You know, although we do use phones and we shoot our little movies for Facebook and for Twitter and all that on our phones, and it's without the cable. You know, everything that we still do on film, as you know and as you can imagine, requires an incredible amount of electricity. So it's a very highly responsible job because it's very dangerous. But when you see gaffer and key grip and best boy and all that, that's usually having to do with, on the gaffer side, electricity.
Yeah, best boy was my next. Are there best girls or just best
Absolutely.
Boys?
Yes. Yeah, you have a best boy who is a female and she's the best girl. But yes.
But never call that.
No, it actually is. It actually is.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
Are these the unsung heroes of the movie making business, or who would you regard sort of as the without them we couldn't get this done?
I think it's actually, man, this may be a very boring explanation or answer to your question, but one of the things that we always do and is one of the things that is more the sexier and glamorous part of the job is going to the premiere and seeing the movie, or we go to a cast and crew screening. And we always get an invitation that always says, yourself plus one. And I think the real heroes of the movie business, this is going to break me up because my wife is a great lady, but I think the real unsung heroes of the film business and the television are the plus ones who stay behind and, you know, take care of they put back teen on the scraped knees and they rush the kids to the emergency room or take them to school while we're off and New Orleans or Seattle or anywhere in between. They're the true heroes because they are the people who keep the families together when, you know, because being gone, I think I was gone for Oz for 8 months, and you know, it's a grind. And, you know, I think most of you guys know my brother is a colonel in the Army and he's got much bigger responsibilities away from the family, so I don't cry for myself at night for being away making a movie, but it is, you ask who the unsung heroes, it is the plus ones who keep it together.
Right answer.
There you go. Can you record that and I can send it to Jen? Yeah.
Could you make sure that that gets...
That'll give me some points.
Yeah, great. You know, not to be morbid here, but we've lost an incredible amount of talent in the last few years. You know, I'm thinking of Anton Yelchin, Alan Rickman, George Kennedy, Robin Williams, Patty Duke, Leonard Nimoy, and lots of household names. Who of those did you really regret that you didn't get the chance to work with?
Man, that's a good question. More than that, I mean, and I think this is going to be more, this is a knee-jerk reaction that I don't think will surprise you, what I regret more is the people I've worked with that I no longer get to work with because they're no longer with us. I think you know Laura Ziskin, who I produced the Spider-Man movies with. She's no longer with us. Joe Caracciolo, who was one of the executive producers of Spider-Man 2 and 3 and was just a great legend in the business, is no longer with us. Bill Nunn, the guy who played Eddie Brock, one of the guys, the African-American gentleman who works at the Daily Bugle, he passed away about 2 months ago. He was a really good cat. You know, he was just a really genuine dude. And I think it's more the people, because anything else is just conjecture. You know, I didn't know Alan Rickman. I obviously admired his talent, one of the amazing actors of all time, but never had that personal connection to him because I never got to work with him. But you lose somebody that you spend 10 years of your professional life with, and those are the people that, as you would imagine, as you know from knowing Laura, that do stick with you and you think about and remember.
Yeah. Just to switch gears slightly, there's a trend now. I guess many of us remember when television emerged, you know, there was this great rancor among filmmakers that, you know, movies were going to go away because everybody was going to stay home and watch television until they saw what television sets looked like in the 50s. And then they rushed back to the theater.
Absolutely.
Now there is a very clear trend toward telling fascinating stories on the small screen, in, you know, movie production quality format.
True.
You know, whether it's Netflix, HBO, Amazon, Epics. Those. Tell me about this, apparent trend. I mean, is it a trend? Is the big screen gonna suffer as a result of that? You know, is there?
I don't think so. I just think they're going to continue to live together because I think you see a lot of big name filmmakers start working in TV, which 5 years ago you didn't see that very often. I don't want to say it was ever snobbish because it wasn't, but it was more pigeonholed. You either did film.
Well, there was a stigma.
There was. Film was a little bit more.
Well, for actors and producers and directors.
Film was a little bit more highbrow, for lack of a better term, but I think, you know, when you get the Amazons of the world and the Netflix of the world that desperately need content, and there's 24 hours in a day and you've got to fill it with that, you know, they're turning to filmmakers and giving them opportunities to tell stories with characters that those writers and directors and actors get to continue playing, and we get invested in them emotionally as viewers of this content. I think that's what draws a lot of people like Spielberg and guys with those recognizable names. They get a canvas to paint on that's not just 2 hours, it's 10 hours, or it's 20 or 30. And I think that's pretty attractive to continue telling good stories.
Yeah, and you know, I think we first saw that actually with Alex Haley's, with the miniseries. I think it was the very first time that a network took an opportunity to say, let's put 2 hours of television on 5 nights in a row and see if anybody watches it.
Oh yeah.
And I don't think anyone's broken their records yet, so it's got to be great to paint on that larger canvas. Have you given that any thought?
Yeah, I would love to do TV. I've got a TV show right now that there's an agency in Los Angeles called CAA, and they're taking a TV show that I have out internationally to buyers. We'll see. It's one of those things that it may not get bought, but I'd love to do television. I'm trying to right now. We'll see if there's any takers.
Now, one of the differences I know that, you know, the movies that you make are of blockbuster sort of proportions, especially when you think about special effects. And a lot of what you see on the smaller screen are more story-oriented. I mean, they're real character-driven stories. I'm fascinated by how you can make what look on the screen to be really simple scenes, but are behind the scenes highly complex. And I think you brought a clip of one that might be interesting to speak about.
Yeah, I'll set that. Some of my students, I think, are here. I see a few. I brought this up in class. You asked earlier about what a producer does too, and this clip is one of the, I think, the more fascinating examples of the effect and the impact a producer has on a movie. When we were doing Spider-Man 3, if you saw the movie, there's a scene in which Bryce Dallas Howard is at a photo shoot. She's a she's getting her picture taken by an actor named Steve Valentine. But it was originally a scene in which this this crane comes swooping into the glass, and what we're getting ready to see it, the floor drops away. But it was a scene that we couldn't afford because, you know, even though we were doing Spider-Man 3, we didn't have an open checkbook. We had a budget, we had to hit it, we couldn't go over it. So it was a scene that got scrapped from the script very, very early on. But as we continued to make that movie, we were about halfway through filming, and we still knew that we needed that scene. And so we started to figure out how in the world, you know, we'd saved a little bit of money through the production by that time, and we had an opportunity to film that scene, but it was still too expensive. And so I remember being in the meeting, and one of the producers of that was Joe Caracciolo Jr. that I brought up earlier, and he was our line producer, and he was really, really smart guy, very creative. And we were trying to figure out the only way that we could afford it is if we could film 24/7 for 4 days straight, which obviously isn't possible. But Joe had this bright idea that if we cast the scene and all the actors in that scene were twins, then one unit could film during the day, and then all the twins could come in at night, and then the second unit could continue filming. And Joe had that idea, and we all giggled for about 5 seconds, and then the room got really quiet because we realized that if we did pull that off, we would be able to have that scene in the movie that Sam desperately wanted. And so that was one of the more creative aspects of filmmaking. And when you watch the scene, it looks fairly uncomplicated. But when you do look at this, keep in mind that everybody in this scene has a twin, except Bryce Dallas Howard. She's the only one without a twin. And all the scenes that you're watching in an office building are in Culver City in California. And then all of the other scenes are in New York. And hopefully, to a degree, we seamlessly tie them together with a lot of people who look alike. So that was it. That's this. Here's a scene from Spider-Man 3.
Okay, Gwen, I've got a secret. It's my coffee. What is that thing doing in my background?
Spidey, hold on. You believe the photo.
Thank God you're okay.
Daddy!
Hey, I'm a new guy. New guy? Now on, I am going to be taking shots of you from the bureau. So, smile. Are you smiling? Just kidding. Big guy, guy. You're Parker? Yeah, look, between you and me, that's kind of an amateur. Have you noticed the stuff makes you look a little bloated? Just, yeah, a little chunky. Okay. You don't have to worry about that anymore, buddy.
Dazzle me.
No special effects there.
No, that was, I'm sure that looks complicated. It was, and it was about five times more complicated. But
wow.
that was the joke, great Joe Caracciolo and the harebrained idea that actually paid off. I don't know if you guys remember the old Hanna-Barbera cartoons where the sheepdog would be guarding the sheep, and then they would trade out the shift, and they'd be both the sheepdog would be talking to each other over a cup of coffee. That's what it was like. But you know, when we would shift from first unit to second unit, you'd see these two people looking exactly alike. It was a fascinating experience.
That's amazing. But the special effects are just mind-boggling. Not just in this, but in each of the real action movies that you've made.
We had a great visual effects team led by John Dykstra and Scott Stockdyke and John Fraser on the mechanical effects side that would blow stuff up and light stuff on fire.
And James Cromwell has got to be one of the great character actors.
Absolutely.
Of his time.
Not too shabby. He was great. He was really good.
That's the police chief.
Yes. And that was Bill Nunn.
If you're not a geek like
us. That was Bill Nunn in the Daily Bugle there at the end.
So yeah.
Really yeah.
Good. Cool. So, I know you've got a couple of things in the works. You're starting to direct. You've directed the pilot?
Well, I directed, I had the honor, I know we've got a lot of townies here in a great way, so a lot of you guys know, if you're my age and a little bit older, you know the great story of a running back the Kansas City Chiefs had named Joe Delaney. And for ESPN last year, I was able to make one of their 30 for 30 short films on Joe Delaney, and it premiered in August. And that was the first thing that I've directed and that had a budget. And that was, of all the movies I've made so far, that was the one that I'm most proud of, simply because I was able to tell Joe Delaney's story, which is truly phenomenal, the ultimate sacrifice for three people, if you didn't know. If you've forgotten or don't know Joe's story, in 1983, Joe Delaney was the Chiefs' rookie all-pro running back, and he had an amazing career ahead of him. The Chiefs thought he was their new Walter Payton. And the summer before what was his third season, but in all honesty, it was really his second season because his technical second season, he was injured. He was in Louisiana on a hot summer day, and he heard help, 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 and he looked over in the pond. Next to him was three young boys who were drowning, and nobody did anything, but Joe, who could not swim, ran into the lake to try to save the boys, and he saved one and sadly passed away with the other two. But it was just an honor to be able to tell Joe's story, and a great Kansas City Chiefs player who I looked up to and admired.
And other directing?
I hope so.
Projects in the
future? It's not something I pursue as much as producing, but I would love to direct again, and I love directing documentaries because that was a true story of a great man. So yeah. I'd love to do it again.
Well, we're going to open it up for audience Q&A in just a second, but submit you to the pain of what many of the actors that you've employed over the years have gone through when they appear on Inside the Actor's Studio. And I don't know how many of you are fans of Inside the Actor's Studio with James Lipton, but he closes each show with a questionnaire that was developed by Frenchman Bernard Pivot.
that apparently tells you a lot. I mean, if you haven't seen it, go on YouTube and pull up Inside the Actor's Studio PIVOT questionnaire, P-I-V-O-T, because I think it's very telling how very famous, from Paul Newman to Robin Williams to Susan Sarandon, you name it, that's been on the show, has answered just this basic 10 questions. So I'm going to throw them at you. And we'll see if...
no pressure here.
If it reveals anything at all that we didn't know. What is your favorite word?
My favorite word? Absolutely. And I use it way too much.
And what is your least favorite word?
Although I use it even more than absolutely... yeah, because I know it is not a good word to use as often as I do.
What turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
The honor that I think it is that you get by producing a product that people will put down $15 and spend 2 hours of their life to be entertained by something you played a small part in bringing to the screen.
And what turns you off?
I can't say what I was getting ready to say. rude people. We'll call them rude. I have another name for them, but I can't say that. But rude people turn me off.
Does it start with an A?
Yes. Okay. That's what I was
saying. Well, I think we can all fill in the blanks.
I don't know if this is this PG-13 or R or PG or what.
Well,
is
interesting. Pivot's fifth question is, what is your favorite curse word? Now on Bravo, they can bleep you out, so you can just tell me backstage.
I'll beep myself.
Yeah, and or we can just use the answer to question four. Yes. As your favorite. What sound or noise do you love?
Oh my gosh, this is gonna make me sound as goofy as I truly am. Oh my goodness, my dog snoring. My wife and I do not have children, but we have two dachshunds who are the craziest dogs in the world, and they snore like a train, and I miss those guys.
And what sound or noise do you hate?
The sound of my voice, because I truly sound like a goofball, but in my own head, I'm like Burt Reynolds or somebody with a cool, sexy voice.
Yeah, aren't we all?
Yes.
So what profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
I always thought I should be pitching for the Royals, but we're playing third base after George Brett, but that didn't work out.
Okay. And what profession would you not like to do?
What profession would I not like to do? I don't know, because I think I would hope that would never happen to somebody, that they would be in a profession that they absolutely did not like. I don't know. If I have to answer that question, I will say this, and I promise you, there's a friend of mine in the audience who is a pilot. I do not like to fly, so I don't think I would want to be a pilot, because that is not one of my that's not one of my highlights, to jump in the plane. So I'll say that, but that would be that.
Great. And the final question, and I won't put the if in front of this, since we're both religious people, heaven exists. What would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
That's a good one. I may need a second to write that. I guess I would hope that... I hope when it's all said and done, somebody at least says that I took advantage of every situation that was put in front of me, but I never took advantage of anyone. That's what I think would be something good to hear.
Well, that's, there couldn't be a better cue for one of your biggest fans. And I'd like the audience to pay very close attention to the adjectives that this person uses as he talks about Grant.
I'm
So, what can I say about Grant Curtis? Well, I can say Grant is a great teacher. I was lucky enough to have my first job in Hollywood working for Grant as his assistant on the Spider-Man movies and getting to work there. I really got to see that he was not only one of the hardest working people on the movie, I saw that he was kind and he was a great manager of people. And I think all of those traits that make Grant such a great producer come so naturally to him because he's such a good guy himself. He's humble and honest and hardworking and very loyal. And he was the same way on the movie he produced for me last year. We worked on a very challenging movie together last year, and I'll never forget that after a hard week of shooting, Grant was always full of energy and he was always there for me to buy me a glass of Maker's Mark, and somehow that nightcap at the end of the week and getting to hang out with Grant for a couple hours and share stories really recharged my batteries after I was exhausted. And he got me inspired to get back to work on Monday morning. So people like Grant just don't exist in Hollywood, and I truly feel that he's one of a kind as a teacher, as a producer, as a collaborator, as a drinking buddy, and as a friend. So cheers, Grant.
Pretty powerful words. I don't know how clear it was in that video, but that was a director named Dave Green. And Dave was, I think it was clear, he was my assistant on Spider-Man 3, but he directed Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, and he's got great hair. But a very humble guy himself, because it was a very surreal experience. I was kind of like a proud uncle. This kid who was Laura Ziskin's daughter's best friend, so he would always be this little kid with a big head running around the set, Spider-Man trying to learn from Sam and you know, be a sponge for anything he could learn. And I hired him as my assistant on Spider-Man 3, and then lo and behold, that was 2009, and by 2016, I'm helping produce his movies, and he's a good cat. He's the real deal.
Well, I tell you, if I were you, I'd grab a copy of that clip, and on those days when you're feeling really good about yourself and you're thinking, I'm pretty hot stuff, I just, you know, replay that and say, humble, loyal,
yes,
kind. So,
well, I will tell you this, I don't know if, I'm trying to see the students who are in the audience. One of the things that was great about teaching this semester was being kept in check by 19, 18 to 22 year olds. And one of them sent me a picture, maybe it's on the internet, but he was ballsy enough to send me a picture of a billboard outside of a video store that says, "We buy used DVDs, except for Spider-Man 3, because that movie sucks." But the point was, I don't need to play that to remain humble. I got it in class every Wednesday from 2:30 to 5:15.
If he sent you the picture, it's on the internet.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Great, thank you. We're going to do Q&A, and I think, John, you want to moderate that?
Great.
Thank you, great.
Thank you.
And a hand to Tim as well. Tim, great questions. Thanks for the interview. We have a microphone down here with Jeff and Bowden, and so that we can hear your questions. And I actually want to start, Grant, with a question. If there is a particular director or actor that you long to work with that you haven't had the chance to work with yet?
You know, one actor I've always wanted to work with, and it's probably just because he's from Missouri as well, is Brad Pitt. Because I think for myself and for my cousin who also works in this business, we grew up always seeing that there was another person from Missouri who went out to Hollywood and made a dent. And also, I think he's a very talented actor, so that would be a highlight.
Great, thank you. Please raise your hand if you have a question, and Jeff will get the microphone to you. Jeff, right down here, please. I know that you're close and we can probably hear you, but since it's being filmed, we actually want to get plugged into the sound system.
The question I have is, you mentioned that you like to do biographies.
And where do you find your stories, or where do you go to get those?
You know, one of the, for Joe, it was, Joe passed away when I was 11, and I was a fan of the Chiefs, as I stated, so that one was just always with me. And then there's other stories. Mitch knows this, and I've tried to get another documentary off the ground for a while now. There's a great football player named Rosie Greer, who had a phenomenal encounter, you know, the night Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. Rosie Greer was actually on his bodyguard detail, if those are the right technical terms, and ended up wrestling the gun from Sirhan Sirhan. I've always wanted to try to tell that story. And honestly, the reason why I've always wanted to tell that story is, I can't remember this, but Mitch brought Rosie to town for some reason, and my dad and Mitch got their picture taken with Rosie Greer, and it always hung in or around my dad's home office, and I always look at that guy and wonder what his story was. It was, so it's a lot of those things, you know. All of us, no matter whether we're 8 or 80, we hear those stories that stick with us, and it really, well, it comes down to a lot of that, to be totally honest.
Somebody in the stands.
Uh-oh, wireless mic is making noise.
Just don't give the mic to her daughter, because that would be dangerous. Eh?
Unfortunately, she's not here. She's at a ball game.
She was
with her son and her
she
daughter.
She can do damage. I grew up with her daughter, so yes.
No, she speaks very highly. Have you ever thought about doing the story of your family, your dad, and their tragedy?
I think there's a very interesting aspect to that. If, for those of you who don't know, that might be me, I don't know. And if you gong me if this becomes too boring, but my dad was always the star student who never missed class. And, you know, one thing that he was going for that particular year was, if you never missed a day of class, you'd get a, give us, and Dad, if I butcher this, correct me, if you made it to every day of school, you'd get a silver dollar at the end of the year. And he was going for that. He'd probably won it for 5 or 7 years straight. And the one day that he missed of school that year, he felt sick, and so he asked my grandmother if he could stay home. And he was resting, I think, with a stomach ache in his room. And my grandmother's name was Marjorie, said, "Dan, why don't you come out into the living room and hang out for a while and lay down on the couch?" And about 2 minutes after my dad laid down on the couch, a B-52 bomber crashed into their house and obliterated their whole house and their whole farm. And my grandmother, who ended up, I don't think she was blind at the time, maybe she was partially blind, she ended up carrying my dad out of the house that was on flames, and literally, there was nothing around them. I mean, it was truly a miracle that they survived, and had my dad still been in his room, he would no longer be with us, and the trickle-down effect, I wouldn't be either. But one of the fascinating aspects of that story is, also on that same day, another Air Force plane crashed in Canada, and I believe maybe another one did somewhere else. So did you guys, was it three?
Yes.
I mean, sadly, you know, with the plane that just crashed with the Brazilian soccer team, you can imagine the odds. We all know the odds of and Tim knows it painfully well. The odds of one plane going down is obviously, thankfully, not good, but the odds of three planes in the height of the Cold War, that's a story that sticks with me to this day. If, I don't know if that's the exact one that you're mentioning, but what a good story of paranoia and intrigue and everything in between. But that one was still, if I could crack a way to have a beginning, a middle, and an end on that story, I would love to, because if you're a fan of the X-Files or something like that, that's one that's a little bit spooky and weird to this day. Good question. That would be a good one.
Somebody else. There's a hand down here, and looks like you found one as well, Jeff.
Hello. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about working for the Disney Company with the Oz film, and if there's a potential that perhaps you and Sam Raimi will be making any further Oz films, or has that been scrapped for, I guess it didn't produce or come out as well as they had expected, although I loved it.
No, it's a good question. And what, as this gentleman is kindly referring to, is the movie did okay. It didn't set any box office records, but it did make money. And I think Disney will make future Oz movies. Frank Baum created an incredible world. L. Frank Baum, I always butcher his name. I lose the L between Frank or leaving it off. But he created an incredible world that, I mean, I think there's 14 books, maybe even more, and I think only scratched the surface. Disney will continue to make those, I think, at some point. I don't know if Sam and I will be involved. It was an honor to be able to tell one of those. I would love to do it again, but I don't know if that's in the cards, but it is an incredible world that guy created. That somebody will continue to tell those stories.
All right, thank you.
Good shirt, by the way. That was...
Jeff, there was
I've been hearing that a lot today.
Hello. For people that are wanting to get into film or getting into the film industry, do you recommend that college-bound students go to a more prestigious film school just because of the programs that they offer and the internships that you can get out of those film schools, or do you just believe that any film school is good and that experience is key to getting better and getting into the industry?
I don't know if any college, you know, prestigious is a unique word. I think college is what you make of it, and the prestige comes with what you bring to the table, because I truly think, you know, whether you go to UCM or any other school, at the end of the day, you represent not only the school, but really you represent yourself. And whatever prestige you bring with it is what you brought to the table. So it's all about experience that you get and that you make while you're there for those four, or in my case, 4.5 years, or in other people's 5 or 6. But and I would also, if you're looking into that, I would do your homework and also find out how quickly you have access to the equipment. I do know at some of the quote-unquote more prestigious schools, you don't get access to equipment until you're a senior. And I do know that at UCM and other schools, as soon as you can turn on the camera and work it, you get the cameras in your hands. So it all depends. I think there's positive and negatives to both. I think it comes down to the individual, though. Yeah. Good question. Thank you.
Thanks for coming tonight. It's
Thanks for having
pleasure.
Me.
Pleasure. It's been a great evening. Have you thought of coming back home and maybe making a film setting here? And you know, it's a beautiful area. We have Pearl Springs, the college, the base, the downtown, the drum, and you can come up with some good scenes, I think.
It's a good question. It should be noted that I did not cue you to ask that question. I would love. My dream is to put together a film fund, and I know this is a big number, it is, of about $15 million and come every summer and make a $5 million movie each summer so that the students here can work on the movie and have real world experience. That's a dream. I would love to do that. I don't know if that'll ever come true because I know how hard it is to raise $1 versus $15 million. But I think it happens in my business all the time, and I don't think that's necessarily what the rest of America sees. We go and make movies everywhere, so making a movie here is no more far-fetched than going to Detroit and making Oz the Great and Powerful. Had a beautiful experience in Detroit, but could have also made that as you can make most movies anywhere. So I believe me, why not Warrensburg? It's a beautiful place. There's a lot of great facilities, as you talked about, Pirtle. We're 45 minutes away from Kansas City, so you could be making a story that had the backdrops of, you know, skyscrapers and everything from here to any other narrative that fits. But I would love to do that, and that's a dream that we'll see whether it comes true or not.
One up here. While it's being passed around, Grant, how important is it for students that are going through any kind of program, the film festival circuit? Are people getting discovered? There's so many film festivals now, and you talked earlier about the technology that we can own on our computers, on our phones. How important is it for students to be submitting their work to film festivals, and what kind of work can often come from that?
I think it's extremely important because one of the aspects of any film festival is being judged, you know, and I think one of the things as a filmmaker and a storyteller, you have to know if you're hitting the right buttons or not. So if nothing else, I think the film festivals offer a great avenue for that. And One of the things I always tell people who send me scripts or short movies or feature links that they've made is I always tell them, it's like, good stories rise to the top because people want to see good stories. And so I think one of the great things that the film festivals have ushered in is a platform for people to have their stuff seen. So I think it's absolutely phenomenal. One of my students, Brock, asked me to be one of the judges of the Film Festival of the Tears, so I saw six great movies, or maybe it was eight, that I wouldn't have been able to see or be entertained by in any other way. So it's a wonderful opportunity.
Thank you.
Hi. Yes. You've been involved in the Spider-Man movies already. I don't know if this is something you're into, but is there any other superhero movies that are coming out at the moment that you would really like to get involved with?
None that I'm involved in, but the one that I always wanted to work on that they've done extremely well, my hat's off to Marvel, I was always a Captain America fan. I think my kindergarten picture, I have a gray, I'm wearing a gray shirt with Captain America on it. So he always held a special place in my heart, and they've done an absolutely phenomenal job with that character.
And if you ever want like a young, handsome Scottish guy for one of your movies, then
I know where to go. The gentleman behind you.
Any other questions?
Kevin.
What's this guy gonna say?
This might be dangerous too.
Hey Grant, I appreciate you coming in, man.
Thanks for having me.
Basically, I was gonna touch on earlier what the young lady said down front there about Warrensburg, you know, if you did have a chance to come back, since you already answered that, I'll go into the, I hear a lot of people on the screen, whatever, saying how kind you are and stuff like that. It's just a comment, not really a question, or it could be construed with a question. Would you go back to your Boy Scout time, you know, clean, reverent, kind, courteous? I mean, it sounds like you've got it all right there.
I had a great Boy Scout experience, so I know you did too. I was the idiot who stopped at life, which for those of you who aren't Boy Scouts, that's the rank right before Eagle. So I don't know why I spent so much time in Bale right before getting to Eagle, which Clark Holder was an Eagle Scout. I look back fondly at, you know, Osceola and all of those experiences you have with the guys that we grew up with in Boy Scout camp and all of those codes to live by. I hope I still drag those to work every day. But yeah, it's a great organization, as you know, and hopefully one day I'll be able to be involved again.
It seems you were noted for your Midwestern ethic, and obviously there's great people in Hollywood, super nice people in Hollywood, but do you find that your Midwestern roots do set you apart from a lot of the people that you work with?
You know, I've been blessed with working with a director and a crew that have been great family men and women, and I've always had the opportunity of seeing the good side of Hollywood. So I think I fit right in with the other people that I work with. So I do think I'm a kind guy, but I think the gaffer and the grip are also kind, and everybody in between. So it's helped, but thankfully, the evil place that sometimes it's portrayed as, and I've had a wonderful experience.
Another question?
Oh, hey. I wanted to take your class, but I already turned it to someone else. Oh, Spider-Man 3 is rad, by the way. I don't know.
It's rad?
Yeah, it's great. Like, to see where he's dancing down the street?
That's awesome. I like it. It's a good one.
All right, so my question is about, like, the Hollywood as an industry is like changing, right?
True.
With all these like franchise films, like the Marvel films and Star Wars, they're like a yearly series now.
Yes.
And they kind of seem like they're planning out like a decade ahead by the producers, and then they kind of slot in like directors after the fact. And I've seen a lot of deep pieces on the internet about how like producers are becoming more of the auteur in like cinema, like Hollywood, like blockbusters. And I wonder if you would agree with that as a producer.
I don't know if I agree with it, because the movies I've done have been great directors, and I think a lot of the Marvel movies and the Star Wars movies have phenomenal directors as well. I will say this, on a lot of movies these days, the role of the producer is becoming more and more powerful, but I think anybody's role on any movies nowadays is becoming more and more powerful because the stakes are so much higher. It is a business, and you know, whether it is any movie, if as a producer, as a director, as a writer, you don't try to influence that and make that as good as you possibly can, there's a lot of risk involved. I mean, you know, you make a $100 million movie that people don't see also then costs $150 million to market. So I don't know if anybody's more powerful than the next guy or gal right now. I just know there's a lot at stake, and people are working their butts off to try to stay in the game and to make another one. It's a good question, though. If you took my class, you would know the history of that question, and you probably do. But it's right now in Hollywood, we're seeing a lot of what founded Hollywood, which was producers and executives wielding an incredible amount of power because the stakes back then were so high, and the stakes are very high to this day.
Just before we get to our next question, I want to just check in with Dean Gershom Nelson. Do we need this to be our last question?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Let's have one more question, and then I'm going to ask Gershom Nelson to come up onto the stage. Go ahead.
Hello. Okay, so my name's Ron Janae. I'm a student producer with KMOS, and this year I'm actually a sophomore, which means I'm eligible for a lot of internships, because, you know, they want that sophomore status before you go in.
Yes.
And I heard a lot of people say that production assistant, and I was talking to my boss the other day because I want to be an on-air talent, and he told me that I most likely want to be a production assistant. So I was just wondering where I find those, because I've just been finding like generic production or engineering, like technical things, not the specific job.
I mean, one of the things that I do know that any of the major studios, if you go on their websites, they'll always take you to a portal about internships and job opportunities. So that's one way. I would really encourage you to do that. And I would also encourage you, if you have the opportunity to have an internship, especially in Los Angeles or New York, and it may not be exactly what you want, but it still gets you out there. Being out there is 99% of the game. To be brutally honest, I don't take anybody seriously until they're in Los Angeles. But sorry about that. Because it's such a big lifestyle change and such a big adjustment, most people don't usually make that leap. But my point is, once you're out there, it's also a very social industry. And so even if you get a marketing internship that's not necessarily on air or with an on-air talent, that still gets you out in the business, and it allows you to start networking. So if you do want to be an on-air talent, I would absolutely encourage you to do that, but I would also not be discouraged if you get an internship in the finance department or in the marketing department or anywhere else, because it is living in New York or living in Los Angeles is an internship in itself, absolutely.
All right, we're going to have one more question. Thank you very much.
My question is more, what advice would you give for someone that wants to get a screenplay in front of someone?
Well, thankfully, it was part of what you were asking. You know, there's a lot of very prestigious screenwriting contests that you can send your screenplay into. And believe me, I promise you, those screenplays get read by multiple people. I mean, for a couple years, I've been a judge in the Baltimore screenwriting competition. But there's a lot of screenwriting competitions all over the place. I think there's a little bit of an entry fee that stings a little bit, but it is also a way for you to be a writer in Warrensburg, Missouri, or Pacoima, or anywhere else in between, and send that in and have people read it that can take that script to the next phase.
So you really wouldn't say get an agent, try and get in that way, or?
Well, an agent is going to be very difficult to grab or to get until you give them a reason to bet on you. And one of the ways that you can give them to bet on you is if you do have success in some of those competitions. I've got agents who are friends and they get 300 phone calls and emails a day. And for somebody they don't know to cut through that noise, that white noise or whatever you want to call it, it's not an easy thing to do, but a very easy thing to do if you've got a great script is to enter a competition and see what the other people, see how it stacks up against other writers.
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast.
We invite you back next week for more fun and adventure.
Until then, remember to keep a pixie in your pocket.
It's that young at heart, positive attitude that you can share with others.
And remember to visit our website at neverlandpodcast.com.
There you can find links to our news page, our shop,
our contact page, where you can easily send an email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com.
You can also find our Neverlanders page, where you can find out how to become an official Lost Boy or Pixie, because girls are too clever to get lost.
Become a real Neverlander.
Please feel free to leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492.
And be sure to follow us on Twitter at NeverlandPCast.
And like our Neverland Podcast fan page on Facebook.
We also have a group on Facebook for you to join.
We also appreciate your support to keep the Neverland Podcast up and running.
Visit patreon.com/NeverlandPodcast to donate to keeping the pixie dust alive.
Copyright content featured on the Neverland Podcast is copyright of their respective creators and used under fair use license.
All original content is copyright of Blue Band Productions, and a very special thanks to Yehaa Bob Jackson at yehaabob.com for our new ending music.
God bless!
Yeah! Hello, everybody, this is Yehaa Bob Jackson. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, it's true.